Cymbeline, King of Britain, by William Shakespeare, narrated by Mark Bowen. Dramatis Personae. Cymbeline, King of Britain. Cloten, son to the queen by a former husband. Posthumus Leonatus, a gentleman, husband to Imogen. Bellarius, a banished lord, disguised under the name of Morgan. Guiderius Arviragus, sons to Cymbeline, supposed sons to Morgan. Falerio, friend to Posthumus. Iachimo, friend to Falerio. A French gentleman, friend to Falerio. Caius Lucius, general of the Roman forces. A Roman captain. Two British captains. Pisanio, servant to Posthumus. Cornelius, a physician. Two lords of Cymbeline's court. Two gentlemen of the same. Two jailers. Queen, wife to Cymbeline. Imogen, daughter to Cymbeline by a former queen. Helen, a lady attending on Imogen. Lords, ladies, Roman senators, tribunes, a Dutch gentleman, a Spanish gentleman, a soothsayer, musicians, officers, captains, soldiers, messengers, and other attendants, apparitions. Scene, sometimes in Britain, sometimes in Rome. Act 1, Scene 1. Britain, the garden of Cymbeline's palace. Enter two gentlemen. First gentleman.
You do not meet a man but frowns. Our bloods no more obey the heavens than our courtiers, still seem as does the king.
Second gentleman.
But what's the matter?
First gentleman.
His daughter, and the heir of his kingdom, whom he purposed to his wife's sole son, a widow, that late he married, hath referred herself unto a poor but worthy gentleman. She's wedded, her husband banished, she imprisoned. All is outward sorrow, though I think the king be touched at very heart.
Second gentleman.
None but the king?
First gentleman.
He that hath lost her too. So is the queen, that most desired the match, but not a courtier. Although they wear their faces to the bent of the king's looks, hath a heart that is not glad at the thing they scowl at.
Second gentleman.
And why so?
First gentleman.
He that hath missed the princess is a thing too bad for bad report, and he that hath her, I mean that married her, alack, good man, and therefore banished, is a creature such as, to seek through the regions of the earth for one his like, there would be something failing in him that should compare. I do not think so fair an outward and such stuff within endows a man but he.
Second gentleman.
You speak him far.
First gentleman.
I do extend him, sir, within himself. Crush him together rather than unfold his measure duly.
Second gentleman.
What's his name and birth?
First gentleman.
I cannot delve him to the root. His father was called Cecilius, who did join his honor against the Romans with Cassibelan, but had his titles by Tenantius, whom he served with glory and admired success, so gained the sure addition Leonatus, and had besides this gentleman in question two other sons, who in the wars of the time died with their swords in hand, for which their father, then old and fond of issue, took such sorrow that he quit being, and his gentle lady, big of this gentleman our theme, deceased as he was born. The king he takes the babe to his protection, calls him Posthumus Leonatus, breeds him, and makes him of his bedchamber, puts to him all the learnings that his time could make him the receiver of, which he took, as we do ere, fast as 'twas ministered, and in his spring became a harvest, lived in court, which rare it is to do, most praised, most loved, a sample to the youngest, to the more mature, a glass that feated them, and to the graver, a child that guided dotards, to his mistress, for whom he now is banished, her own price proclaims how she esteemed him and his virtue. By her election may be truly read what kind of man he is.
Second gentleman, I honor him, even out of your report. But pray you tell me, is she sole child to the king?
First gentleman, his only child. He had two sons, if this be worth your hearing, mark it. The eldest of them, at 3 years old, in the swathing clothes the other, from their nursery were stolen, and to this hour no guess in knowledge which way they went.
Second gentleman,
how long is this ago?
First gentleman,
some 20 years.
Second gentleman,
that a king's children should be so conveyed, so slackly guarded, and the search so low, that could not trace them.
First gentleman, howsoe'er it is strange, or that the negligence may well be laughed at, yet is it true, sir?
Second gentleman, I do well believe you.
First gentleman,
we must forbear. Here comes the gentleman, the queen, and princess.
Exeunt. Enter the queen, Posthumus, Leonatus, and Imogen.
Queen.
No, be assured you shall not find me, daughter, after the slander of most stepmothers, evil-eyed unto you. You're my prisoner, but your jailer shall deliver you the keys that lock up your restraint. For you, Posthumus, so soon as I can win the offended king, I will be known your advocate. Marry, yet the fire of rage is in him, and 'twere good you leaned into his sentence with what patience your wisdom may inform you.
Posthumus Leonatus.
Please, your highness, I will from hence today.
Queen.
You know the peril. I'll fetch a turn about the garden, pitying the pangs of barred affections, though the king hath charged you should not speak together.
Exit.
Imogen.
Dissembling courtesy! How fine this tyrant can tickle where she wounds! My dearest husband, I something fear my father's wrath, but nothing, always reserved my holy duty, what his rage can do on me. You must be gone, and I shall here abide the hourly shot of angry eyes, not comforted to live, but that there is this jewel in the world, that I may see again.
Posthumus Leonatus.
My queen, my mistress, O lady, weep no more, lest I give cause to be suspected of more tenderness than doth become a man. I will remain the loyalest husband that did e'er plight troth. My residence in Rome, at one Falerio's, who to my father was a friend, to me known but by letter. Thither write, my queen, and with mine eyes I'll drink the words you send, though ink be made of gall.
Re-enter Queen.
Queen. Be brief, I pray you. If the king come, I shall incur I know not how much of his displeasure.
Aside. Yet I'll move him to walk this way.
I never do him wrong, but he does buy my injuries, to be friends, pays dear for my offences.
Exit.
Posthumus Leonatus. Should we be taking leave as long a term as yet we have to live, the loathsomeness to depart would grow. Adieu.
Imogen.
Nay, stay a little. Were you but riding forth to air yourself, such parting were too petty. Look here, love. This diamond was my mother's. Take it, heart, but keep it till you woo another wife, when Imogen is dead.
Posthumus Leonatus.
How? Another? You gentle gods, give me but this I have, and sear up my embracements from a next with bonds of death.
Putting on the ring.
Remain thou here, while sense can keep it on, and sweetest, fairest, as I my poor self did exchange for you, to your so infinite loss, so in our trifles, I still win of you. For my sake, wear this, it is a manacle of love, I'll place it upon this fairest prisoner.
Putting a bracelet upon her arm.
Imogen. Oh, the gods! When shall we see again?
Enter Cymbeline and lords. Posthumus Leonatus.
Alack, the king!
Cymbeline.
Thou basest thing, avoid! Hence from my sight! If after this command thou fraught the court with thy unworthiness, thou diest! Away! Thou art poison to my blood!
Posthumus Leonatus.
The gods protect you, and bless the good remainders of the court. I am gone.
Exit. Imogen.
There cannot be a pinch in death more sharp than this is.
Cymbeline.
Ho, disloyal thing, that shouldst repair my youth, thou heap'st a year's age on me.
Imogen.
I beseech you, sir, harm not yourself with your vexation. I am senseless of your wrath. A touch more rare subdues all pangs, all fears.
Cymbeline.
Past grace? Obedience?
Imogen.
Past hope and in despair. That way, past grace.
Cymbeline.
That mightst have had the sole son of my queen.
Imogen.
Oh, blessed that I might not. I chose an eagle, and did avoid a puttock.
Cymbeline.
Thou took'st a beggar, wouldst have made my throne a seat for baseness.
Imogen.
No, I rather added a luster to it.
Cymbeline.
Oh, thou vile one!
Imogen.
Sir, it is your fault that I have loved Posthumus. You bred him as my playfellow, and he is a man worth any woman, overbuys me almost the sum he pays.
Cymbeline.
What, art thou mad?
Imogen.
Almost, sir. Heaven restore me. Would I were a neatherd's daughter, and my Leonatus, our neighbor shepherd's son.
Cymbeline.
Thou foolish thing!
Re-enter Queen.
They were again together. You have done naught after our command. Away with her, and pen her up.
Queen,
beseech your patience. Peace, dear lady daughter, peace. Sweet sovereign, leave us to ourselves, and make yourself some comfort out of your best advice.
Cymbeline,
nay, let her languish a drop of blood a day, and being aged, die of this folly.
Exeunt Cymbeline and lords. Queen,
fie! You must give way.
Enter Pisanio.
Here is your servant. How now, sir? What news?
Pisanio.
My lord your son drew on my master.
Queen.
Ha! No harm, I trust, is done.
Pisanio.
There might have been, but that my master rather played than fought, and had no help of anger. They were parted by gentlemen at hand.
Queen.
I am very glad, aunt.
Imogen.
Your son's my father's friend. He takes his part to draw upon an exile. Oh, brave sir! I would they were in Afric both together, myself by with a needle, that I might prick the goer by. Why came you from your master?
Pisanio.
On his command, he would not suffer me to bring him to the haven. Left these notes of what commands I should be subject to, when it pleased you to employ me.
Queen,
this hath been your faithful servant. I dare lay mine honor he will remain so.
Pisanio,
I humbly thank your highness.
Queen,
pray walk a while.
Imogen,
about some half hour hence, I pray you speak with me. You shall at least go see my lord abroad. For this time, leave me.
Exeunt.
Scene 2.
the same. A public place. Enter Cloten and two lords. First Lord.
Sir, I would advise you to shift a shirt. The violence of action hath made you reek as a sacrifice. Where air comes out, air comes in. There's none abroad so wholesome as that you vent.
Cloten.
If my shirt were bloody, then to shift it. Have I hurt him?
Second Lord. Aside.
No, faith, not so much as his patience.
First Lord.
Hurt him? His body's a passable carcass, if he be not hurt. It is a thoroughfare for steel, if it be not hurt.
Second Lord. Aside.
His steel was in debt. It went o' the backside the town.
Cloten.
The villain would not stand me.
Second Lord. Aside.
No, but he fled forward still, toward your face.
First Lord.
Stand you. You have land enough of your own, but he added to your having, gave you some ground.
Second Lord. Aside.
As many inches as you have oceans.
Puppies.
Cloten. I would they had not come between us.
Second Lord. Aside.
So would I, till you had measured how long a fool you were upon the ground.
Cloten.
And that he should love this fellow, and refuse me.
Second Lord. Aside.
If it be a sin to make a true election, she is damned.
First Lord.
Sir, as I told you always, her beauty and her brain go not together. She's a good sign, but I have seen small reflection of her wit.
Second Lord. Aside.
She shines not upon fools, lest the reflection should hurt her.
Cloten.
Come, I'll to my chamber. Would there had been some hurt done.
Second Lord. Aside.
I wish not so, unless it had been the fall of an ass, which is no great hurt.
Cloten.
You'll go with us.
First Lord.
I'll attend your lordship.
Cloten.
Nay, come, let's go together.
Second Lord.
Well, my lord.
Exeunt. Scene 3. A room in Cymbeline's palace. Enter Imogen and Pisanio.
Imogen. I would thou grew'st unto the shores of the haven, and question'st every sail. If he should write, and not have it, 'twere a paper lost, as offered mercy is. What was the last that he spake to thee?
Pisanio.
It was his queen. His queen?
Imogen.
Then waved his handkerchief?
Pisanio.
And kissed it, madam?
Imogen.
Senseless linen, happier therein than I. And that was all?
Pisanio.
No, madam, for so long as he could make me with his eye or ear distinguish him from others, he did keep the deck with glove or hat or handkerchief, still waving, as the fits and stirs of his mind could best express how slow his soul sailed on, how swift his ship.
Imogen.
Thou shouldst have made him as little as a crow, or less, or left to after eye him.
Pisanio.
Madam, so I did.
Imogen.
I would have broke mine eye-strings, cracked them but to look upon him, till the diminution of space had pointed him sharp as my needle, nay, followed him, till he had melted from the smallness of a gnat to air, and then have turned mine eye and wept. But good Pisanio, when shall we hear from him?
Pisanio.
Be assured, madam, with his next vantage.
Imogen.
I did not take my leave of him, but had most pretty things to say, ere I could tell him how I would think on him at certain hours, such thoughts and such, or I could make him swear the she's of Italy should not betray mine interest and his honour. or have charged him, at the sixth hour of morn, at noon, at midnight, to encounter me with orisons, for then I am in heaven for him. Or, ere I could give him that parting kiss, which I had set betwixt two charming words, comes in my father, and, like the tyrannous breathing of the north, shakes all our buds from growing.
Enter a lady.
Lady. The queen, madam, desires your highness' company.
Imogen.
Those things I bid you do, get them dispatched. I will attend the queen.
Pisanio.
Madam, I shall.
Exeunt. Scene 4. Rome. Filario's house. Enter Filario, Iacomo, a Frenchman, a Dutchman, and a Spaniard.
Iacomo. Believe it, sir, I have seen him in Britain. He was then of a crescent note, expected to prove so worthy as since he hath been allowed the name of. But I could then have looked on him without the help of admiration, though the catalogue of his endowments had been tabled by his side, and I to peruse him by items.
Filario.
You speak of him when he was less furnished than now he is, with that which makes him both without and within.
Frenchman.
I have seen him in France. We had very many there could behold the sun with as firm eyes as he.
Iacomo.
This matter of marrying his king's daughter, wherein he must be weighed rather by her value than his own, words him, I doubt not, a great deal from the matter.
Frenchman.
And then his banishment.
Iacomo.
Aye, and the approbation of those that weep this lamentable divorce under her colors are wonderfully to extend him. Be it but to fortify her judgment, which else an easy battery might lay flat, for taking a beggar without less quality. But how comes it he is to sojourn with you? How creeps acquaintance?
Filario.
His father and I were soldiers together, to whom I have been often bound for no less than my life. Here comes the Briton. Let him be so entertained amongst you as suits, with gentlemen of your knowing, to a stranger of his quality.
Enter Posthumus Leonatus.
I beseech you all, be better known to this gentleman, whom I commend to you as a noble friend of mine. How worthy he is I will leave to appear hereafter, rather than story him in his own hearing.
Frenchman.
Sir, we have known together in Orleans.
Posthumus Leonatus.
Since when I have been debtor to you for courtesies, which I will be ever to pay, and yet pay still.
Frenchman.
Sir, you o'errate my poor kindness. I was glad I did atone my countrymen and you. It had been a pity you should have been put together with so mortal a purpose as then each bore, upon importance of so slight and trivial a nature.
Posthumus Leonatus.
By your pardon, sir, I was then a young traveller, rather shunned to go even with what I heard than in my every action to be guided by others' experiences. But upon my mended judgment, if I offend not to say it is mended, my quarrel was not altogether slight.
Frenchman.
Faith, yes, to be put to the arbitrament of swords, and by such two that would by all likelihood have confounded one the other, or have fallen both.
Iacomo.
Can we with manners ask what was the difference?
Frenchman.
Safely, I think. 'Twas a contention in public, which may, without contradiction, suffer the report. It was much like an argument that fell out last night, where each of us fell in praise of our country mistresses, this gentleman at that time vouching, and upon warrant of bloody affirmation, his to be more fair, virtuous, wise, chaste, constant, qualified, and less attemptable than any the rarest of our ladies in France.
Iacomo.
That lady is not now living, or this gentleman's opinion by this worn out.
posthumously Inatus. She holds her virtue still, and I my mind.
Iachimo, you must not so far prefer her 4 hours of Italy.
Posthumously Inatus. Being so far provoked as I was in France, I would abate her nothing, though I profess myself her adorer, not her friend.
Iachimo, as fair and as good a kind of hand-in-hand comparison had been something too fair and too good for any lady in Britain. If she went before others I have seen, as that diamond of yours outlusters many I have beheld, I could not but believe she excelled many. But I have not seen the most precious diamond that is, nor you the lady.
Posthumously Inatus. I praised her as I rated her. So do I my stone.
Iachimo. What do you esteem it at?
Posthumously Inatus. More than the world enjoys.
Iachimo. Either your unparagoned mistress is dead, or she's outprized by a trifle.
Posthumously Inatus. You are mistaken. The one may be sold or given, if there were wealth enough for the purchase.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.